Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies from Michael Mara, who is the Deputy Convener and cannot attend today's meeting. That means that as the oldest member of the committee, I will be convening the meeting for the first item of business for the purposes of the committee choosing a convener. I would like to put on record our thanks to Keith Brown for his work during the time on the committee and to welcome back Kenneth Gibson. The first item on our agenda is to choose a convener. The committee has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee. As such, I nominate Kenneth Gibson as convener of the committee. Do members agree to choose Kenneth Gibson as our convener?
Yes.
As there are no objections, I congratulate Kenneth on your appointment and give you the chair.
Committee for my appointment, particularly my colleagues Michael Mara and John Mason, who have convened the meetings in my absence. And as I rejoin the committee, I wish to declare I have no relevant interests. For our next agenda item, the committee will continue our inquiry into the Scottish Commons Public Service Reform Programme. Today we hear from Sarah Waters, Director of Membership and Resources COSLA, and Cleland Sneddon, Chief Executive of South Lanarkshire Council, representing Solace Scotland. I welcome you both to the meeting. I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. If witnesses would like to be brought into the discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks and then I will call you. We've no written submissions, so we will move straight to questions. And first of all, before I ask any questions, I just want to say how impressed I was by the quality and the detail in the submission. It was an excellent piece of work. It has to be said, there was one very clear and overriding statement I would suggest, or from local government, which is that, and I quote from paragraph 9 of your summary of key points, local government requires fair and sustainable funding and greater empowerment. So those themes kind of run right through the document. One thing, though, I would say, though, is, and this is, I found this frustrating with COSLA on a number of occasions, and that's that although there is talk of fair and sustainable funding, and I think everyone in the committee is very sympathetic to that, three members of the committee here today are former councillors, for example, and, of course, Douglas was a council leader. There is no detail as to what that really means. Fair and sustainable funding, I feel. So it would be good if that could be expanded on a wee bit, and then we'll touch on that a wee bit more, and then we'll go on to other points. Who wants to go first? Cleland.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for inviting us through to provide some evidence today. Fair and sustainable funding. To give a bit of illustration, and it's within the submission, if Scottish local government had shared the same fiscal fortunes as Scottish government over the period from 2013-14, we would have round about £1.289 billion more in our collective budgets. The origin of that, Audit Scotland did some work for us looking at the comparative change, real terms, in our budgets. And the Scottish Government's budget over that period of time went up by 4.3% in real terms. In real terms, Scottish local government went down by 4.2%. However, we asked them to do a little bit further work to identify the true impact on core budgets for Scottish local government if you removed directed funding to deliver on a number of Scottish Government priorities. And the real terms reduction in that period is 9.6%. So the swing, if you want, is 13.8% of a difference in fiscal fortunes. If we're not looking for more than anybody else, but we believe that the impact of that has meant a period, to be honest, 15 years now since 2008, where we've delivered very significant efficiencies And in my own authority's case, that's well over £200 million worth of efficiencies in that period. But the impact of that now is starting to appear in relation to the delivery of public services. It's no longer sustainable to continue to do what we deliver on behalf of our communities, but that's at a time when demand is at an all-time high. So just very quickly, I'll give you one example, which is in relation to homelessness. So the homelessness caseloads for my authority is 70% greater than it was last year, 70% in terms of caseloads. Homeless presentations are up in the recent period by about 10%. So there is tremendous pressure on Scottish local government. A lot of people are looking to us to try and help mitigate the cost of living crisis and to deal with a range of challenges. But as I said, the fiscal position has been very difficult for us. And very final point, because I'm sure you will return to it, is the flexibilities that are afforded to local government in terms of how it uses the resources available to them. And we have, I think, in the last year from 21-22 to 22-23, we've seen that directed spend increase from 18% to 23% alone. So hopefully that gives you a starting point for the discussion.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to talk all about budgetary stuff because obviously this is more about reform, but I mean, this is the core of a lot of what you've been saying throughout, and so I will ask one or two questions on that. Before I let Sarah in, the figures you mentioned from paragraph 46, you talk about, you know, the increase in Scottish Government funding of 4.3% of other areas over the same period, but is that the case if you were to take out the NHS, for example? I mean, I think the difficulty has been that with an ageing and more frail population, that any government of any colour would have, perhaps you can argue around the percentages here and there, but would have put a disproportionate amount of additional funding where it is available into the NHS just because of it being demand-led. For example, a 25% increase in A&E pre-pandemic cases over 5 years. You know, we've seen a 50% increase in radiographers and a doubling of the number of psychiatrists in the NHS, and it's still not enough. So, I mean, so is that not the kind of context in which we operate? It's not as if the way that you kind of responded was as if we're all heading in the same direction at the same pace, but there are some areas of the Scottish Government where the pressures are clearly absolutely in your face. And I think that whatever you can argue about priorities, and I think that's crucial that we do, but that's really the kind of back picture, is it not, against an overall fairly, you know, flat funding settlement over a number of years.
So, Convener, the intent is not to do a direct comparison with NHS, who undoubtedly have pressures, but the same language in relation to demand-led services applies to local government. So the way you characterise demographic change and changes in demand are things that we would recognise as well. And unfortunately, we would suggest that the fiscal fortunes that we've enjoyed since 2008 hasn't been in keeping with those particular pressures. I'm actually very proud of the work that the Scottish local government does. I think we innovate and have been extremely creative. We wouldn't have been able to survive the changes in those fiscal fortunes if we hadn't been that creative. I suppose the point I would make just now is that we're at a bit of a tipping point. In particular, when we have protected areas of services or relatively protected areas of services around things like education, around adult social care, the impact on the other services, everything from roads budgets through to environmental health, etc., that we saw the value of during the pandemic, and every other service area has been impacted and will continue to be impacted. It's difficult to see how over the next couple of years, particularly with the inflationary context that we're all facing at the moment, we can ensure that those services are maintained.
Yeah, I'm going to ask you a wee bit about these kind of things as we move on. I mean, you keep saying since 2008, interestingly, but as I recall, the previous administration actually had a policy of top slicing 3% of local government funding year in, year out. That was actually going to be their policy. So I think that you would have found this situation regardless of who'd been in administration. But Sarah, fair funding sounds good, but how much is fair funding? This is the issue. Given that the local government is as aware as the rest of us of the pressures the Scottish Government, indeed the UK Government, are under financially, how realistic is it to expect additional funding for local government over and above average any average increase in settlement that may come to the Scottish Government over the next year?
So you're absolutely right. It is a term that COSLA has used for a number of years, and we talk about sort of core funding and then the directed funding. I think there's a lot of transparency and scrutiny of things like ring-fenced funding, directed funding, but I think there's less transparency around the huge chunk of funding that sits in the general revenue grant that's distributed via the GAE formula. And I think what we'd like to get into in terms of the fiscal framework this year is actually getting into that and saying, well, what do you need for a minimum service provision? So as part of the fiscal framework work, we've been leading some work with directors of finance to actually get under the skin of that and say, well, actually, what are the key cost pressures? What are the key cost drivers in delivering services that people expect, right from all the services that Cleland's mentioned, the education services, the social care services, right through to the roads and the other range of services. So I don't think we've ever we have called out those differences between those two sort of tranches of funding, but we haven't actually, you know, actually got into the detail, and that's what we hope to do. I think that there's also a fundamental flaw with things like, you know, you have a financial memorandum that's written at a point in time, you have a pot of funding that's then lobbed into the settlement. COSLA calls quite rightly to get that put into the general revenue grant, which gives flexibility, but it is subject to demand and inflationary pressures, and we don't revisit those amounts of funding. There's been a lot of talk recently about the early learning and childcare funding and whether or not that should be baselined. But again, just because there are perhaps fewer children and young people in the system, it doesn't mean that local government can, you know, just close nurseries or take provision out. There are minimum standards that are required. You need a certain amount of properties to deliver early learning and childcare in rural areas. You need staff in terms of ratios, and people that are working in that sector also need to be paid a fair wage. And there's a lot of talk about sustainable rates. That's absolutely right. But to do that, you need to factor that into the overall envelope of funding that you have available. So I think we need a very honest discussion with our Scottish Government colleagues about what is and is not affordable from the envelope of funding that is available. And if there's no more funding available, then we need to start talking about what we stop delivering. Because I think local government, as Cleland said, has managed and managed. But I think now things like the local government benchmarking framework are starting to show cracks in some areas. And, you know, it is really regrettable. Some of the decisions that have had to be made are leading to perhaps, you know, reductions in satisfaction, etc. But that's the reality of the situation. Things are going to have to stop. We cannot continue to salami slice things anymore. So we're hoping that through the fiscal framework development, we can get a space for those very robust discussions.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is a positive development. I hope it certainly will prove to be so. I mean, one of the things that the Scottish Government is doing is been increasing benefits relative to south of the border, such that by about 2028, it'll be about £1.4 billion. Now, I've spoken to people in local government who've told me that some of that money would be better actually spent on the local government services that actually help to underpin, work against poverty and to reduce poverty. So I'm just wondering if local government in Scotland has undertaken any cost-benefit analysis to look at where a pound spent in local government, for example, as against, you know, one of these measures in terms of benefits, or indeed any other measure in Scottish government spend, has been undertaken, so that you can be clear about the value for money aspect of the work that local government does.
Convener, if I can maybe make a couple of remarks before Sarah comes in on this. The value of local government services and the impact, if I can give you an example around child poverty, you will find that most authority or partnerships, community planning partnerships actually, child poverty action plans, will generally have three strands. First of all, maximising the income for a particular household. Secondly, trying to manage the cost of living, the cost of the day. And thirdly, to try and support people into sustained and valued employment. The first two are really helpful. They are critical supports for households in need, but in themselves they will not lift households out of poverty. The latter part, which is about skills development, about employability support, about getting people into sustained employment, paying a decent living wage, those are the routes out of debt. It's the routes out of poverty. So when you see local government services, and I'm just going to narrow it down because your point is a broader point around this, that you need to think about individual interventions that local government does, because you can't do a cost-benefit analysis on local government because of the breadth of things we do.
Big points of what you do clearly.
But that type of thing around employability, those are the very budgets that are under pressure. Mm-hmm. Those are the very budgets, even with the No One Left Behind supports and the flexibilities, which were very, very welcomed in around that expenditure. Those are the particular areas where we could intervene to help families. It's about giving families and households a hand up rather than a hand out. So I am not by any means critical of the monies that have been routed into households through enhanced benefits. You know, those are extraordinarily welcome. But you do have to question what's the long-term and sustainable aspect of this, and can you use some of that money over the longer term more strategically and actually help people out of poverty as opposed to creating a dependency on an enhanced benefit rate? I'll maybe pass to Sarah. Thanks, Chair.
Yeah, I'd be happy to follow up about the point about, you know, pounds spent in local governments, because we do have information. I just don't have it to hand this morning. But I think, you know, we have pulled heavily on research by the World Health Organization, the Health Foundation, that actually looks at the importance of investing in the determinants of health, the housing, the employability support, transport, etc. I think if you look at things like adult social care, I mean, there are very, very stark examples of the benefits and the cost benefits of keeping older people in their home, not allowing them to trip and slip and avoiding them going into A&E, £25,000, I think, for a hip fracture. You can do a lot of home care support for £25,000. I think the other area, and Cleland was talking about, you know, getting people into work, etc., take a step back from that and go into the classroom and think about the classroom support that is required. So pupils that require, with ASN, who require, you know, additional support needs, if we can get them the support they need early in the classroom, and that's not necessarily teachers, that is potentially sometimes one-to-one to support that gets them on the road to achieving and attaining at school, that then will give them a better chance in the employment market. So I think you can, you know, go a step back and allow councils the flexibility to provide that whole family support that some of which will be delivered directly in the classroom.
Okay, thanks. I mean, the medium-term financial strategy in the Scottish Government's fiscal outlook says, and I quote, it's for individual public bodies to determine the target operating model for their workforces and to ensure workforce plans and projections are affordable in 23, 24 and over the medium term. Is that something you consider to be realistic at this time?
I think there's a bit of... I think for local government, you'll see a diagram in the submission that shows the kind of local government reform agenda, which, you know, we clearly are demonstrating with our submission that we've been on this journey for quite some time. And now the public service reform agenda that is sitting with Scottish Government, there is an overlap point that I think we are concerned about, that if public service reform happens over here and local government continues to reform, we need to consider... I think the concerning thing for me in that statement is the each individual, and I think we need to think about, you know, what are the services that are needed in individual places and how do those public service bodies interact with local government on the ground, because I think there's a danger of everybody ploughing their own furrow and actually there's unintended consequences there of cutting services in one place that actually would have been really well delivered in partnership with local government on the ground. So I think this comes down to thinking about community planning partnerships, how they can be more empowered to take the decisions and plan the services that they need, but then how the kind of national bodies can actually enable that, because I think there's a danger if they reform in silos, then we miss the kind of overlap that we need to get better services on the ground.
One of the important parts of reform is digitalisation, and it's clear that there has to be cooperation between Scottish Government and local government, so I'm a wee bit concerned about some of the comments that you've made in your submission. So, for example, in paragraph 43, you say, My Job Scotland, managed by COSLA, which has streamlined the recruitment process for councils and other public sector bodies, although the Scottish Government's agencies have opted not to use it. And then in paragraph 70, you talk about the digital strategy. Both COSLA and the Scottish Government committed to develop and expand Digital Boost as our primary programme of support for SMEs. Despite this, the programme saw its budget reduced by a quarter for 2022-23, and indications are it's unlikely to be funded in 2023-24. So clearly this collaboration perhaps isn't working as well as it should. What are the reasons why, for example, the Scottish Government is not using My Job Scotland, and what is the reason for the digital strategy support for SMEs not being continued, as it seems?
If I could just come in on the My Job Scotland point, I mean, we believe in local government that My Job Scotland is a world-class product. I am unsure as to the reasons why the Scottish Government and other agencies are not using that. I think we have had discussions, but I think as part of the reform agenda, we need to go further with those discussions. I think sometimes it's the initial steps are difficult, so, you know, Scottish Government and its agencies will have its own things that it's used to, it'll have its own systems that... You know, it's all a bit painful at some point, but I think it's, you know, I think the cost benefits of using things like My Job Scotland are absolutely clear. We've got some really clear, you know, stats that show that it is much more cost effective to use this, and we're reaching, I think, 2.5 million people across Scotland. You know, that is a huge percentage of the working age population. So I think we need to have those discussions again. It might have been that they were had at a point in time, and we need to go further. I think the Digital Boost investment is disappointing. I think we have had various discussions about that. It's a programme that I think business has absolutely appreciated, and unfortunately COSLA has had to make two staff redundant because of the funding not being continued for those posts. We will develop ways of delivering support for business. We'll use digitisation to make sure we're delivering those, but actually having those two dedicated posts did reap benefits for business, which we know because we've got evidence from business surveys on that.
Ellen.
Thanks, Convener. And maybe just to pick out another example, you know, Sarah's mentioned that the authorities have gone on a digital-first journey, where we have moved an awful lot of our services into a digital platform so that customers can interact with us at a time of their choosing and a location of their choosing, and do transact business. But the one I would want to maybe just pick out as an exemplar is the work around the CMIS system. So CMIS, which evolved from the Education Computer Support Unit in Strathclyde, migrated every local authority on one at a time as their existing contracts expired. We now have a fully integrated system that covers all schools, all early learning establishments in Scotland. We don't lose children any longer, because you have to create a record to delete a record and vice versa. The benefits around the development of this system are substantial. It's going through a further evolution, both in terms of its early learning module and its secondary module. I said I'm not going to do comparisons sector to sector. I'm about to do to contradict myself. But just to give an example, in health, there is such a plethora of systems that are used by GP practices, by primary care settings, by acute settings, etc. It's very difficult for somebody walking in through the door at an A&E for the medical professional to then access records back at the person's practice. They don't know the chronologies, etc. If you go into an A&E and there's a referral back to your GP, they're sending letters, etc. There is a lot of manual transactions within health. The route that we've taken around CMIS is the exemplar. It does need more, right across the Scottish public sector, more of that type of thinking, more bold decision-making, and actually decisions that then migrate services onto a single platform. I'll give you the equivalent for our social care services. It's like walking up to a system with a charger for a different type of handset. You don't know where to plug in because it doesn't fit. So I couldn't even give you the figure for the number of different systems that GP practices in Scotland currently operate. It cannot be without the wit of man to think about how do we get a single system and how do we migrate over time. And we are embarked on things like the single health and social care record. That's a unique identifier. We're doing that in conjunction with colleagues in Scotland and in the Scottish Government. But actually, that's only the tip of the iceberg. We should be looking at whole systems like the CMIS model. So I would commend that. But there are many examples. And the final thing is just you'll see within our submission, there's a reference to My Account, which again is another exemplar system that gives the opportunity for 40 organisations to have a single sign-in service for public services. But we understand there is now work ongoing for a thing called Digital Identity Scotland. It would duplicate, it would compete with this. I cannot, I must admit, understand why we would look to develop in Scotland a competitor system for something that's already up and running.
Yeah, I think that's a point well made. I know you're going to come in, Sarah, but I'm trying to move on because I want colleagues to come in. I mean, I could spend the whole session asking questions because there's so much really good detail here. But one of the things, I'll just ask this one other question then. It's best practice. I mean, I think what's good about this document is that there's some tremendous examples of good practice. And you for example, Renfrewshire Council's Tackling Poverty Commission, North Ayrshire Council's Skills for Life programme, Eastern Bartonshire Council's Snack and Play programme. And you do give an example, for example, of North Ayrshire's community wealth building programme, which is expanding throughout Scotland. But it's just to see, one of the things I've asked over many years in a number of committees is about how such good practice is actually spread throughout local government. Because one of the concerns I've always had is that, yeah, they have a great project in Council X and another brilliant project in Council Y, but there's not really as much sharing and cross-cutting as there should be to ensure that these projects are implemented on a much wider basis.
Yeah. Sorry, Convener, probably Sarah would give you a more rounded answer. There's two things around this. One is the continuation of short-term pilot funding, pilotitis. You know, actually, to be honest, we kind of know what works. It might look slightly different, and different areas might have a different title, etc. The North Ayrshire work on community wealth building is exemplar, but by no means unique. And you'll find a number of authorities who get very similar programmes. The East Ayrshire programme around vibrant communities, and I think in the document it hints at 65 community asset transfers, again, is an exemplar, but it's by no means unique. We have, through colleagues in the Local Government Improvement Service, the Knowledge Hub, and a whole range of other mechanisms, including the professional networks like Scott's network for roads, etc., the heads of planning services, HOPS for planning services. There are these mechanisms to share good practice and to try and consider what would work within your local area. So the problem, if I would describe it that way, is we almost get to a point of seeing something that works, but it doesn't automatically give you an immediate disinvestment. And the best example I can give you on scale is the work that was done through the Early Learning Collaborative. It then became the Early Learning and Childcare Collaborative. It probably will take a generation of children, to see the true benefits of that. But again, the pressure on local government budgets that contribute to that, including things like leisure and sport, etc., that are part of that kind of healthy lifestyle and opportunities, etc., for our young people, the pressure on these short-term budgets means that there is a difficulty in sustaining the services. But I don't have concerns about our internal mechanisms to share good practice and then think about what would work best in our locality. Final point I would make is delivering certain services in Tyree, for example, will look dramatically different to rural Aberdeenshire, and it will look dramatically different to the east end of Glasgow. It has to be place-specific. Don't know if Sarah wants to add.
Yeah. The committee will be aware that obviously we've had a COVID recovery strategy programme board up until fairly recently. It met a couple of weeks ago, and it's looking at, you know, the options for the future. But the Community Planning Improvement Board was one of the key players in that, and I think there's some examples in the submission around the pilot work that's being done in Dundee, the Pathfinder work done in Glasgow. There were three strands of the Community Planning Improvement Board's work. One was climate change, financial security and child poverty, so mapped very closely to the three missions in the First Minister's prospectus. The three work streams which involved people from Scottish Government, SCVO, Scottish Enterprise, all sorts of stakeholders were involved in those pilots, and there was a couple of things that came up in every single work stream. One was funding fragmentation, sustainability of funding for the third sector, and data sharing. So there are things that these pilots, this Community Planning Improvement Board work is telling us that have been around for years. I mean, some of those when I was a community planning coordinator 20 years ago, I could have said that some of those things, data sharing, for example. But I think that what we've got to do is take those issues out of those spaces and say, what can we fundamentally do through the partnership agreement that we're hopefully going to sign next week between local and Scottish Government, and actually drive the improvement that is required to make us have an environment that we can share data securely. The funding landscape is much less fragmented, and it's much more sustainable, so that we can start to plan. But like Cleland, I don't think there's any problem sharing. I think we have a lot of really good mechanisms to share. It's just sometimes it's really frustrating that these same issues keep coming up, but we're not necessarily addressing them. I think the pilots highlight things, but we need to take those and kind of make them the big issues that we have to tackle.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to open up the session. First colleague to ask a question will be John, to be followed by Ross.
Okay, thanks very much. We've had various evidence already on this subject, as you may have realised. And one of the things that we were told was that the kind of budget pressures and having to find efficiencies, which you've both been talking about, are not the same as fundamental reform. And I wonder if you agree with that. Is reform something different? And if so, what is it?
Thank you, Mr. Mason and convener. I think we're at a crossroads point now, and I think the partnership agreement sets the platform for perhaps a greater shared narrative. I said recently to elected members in my authority that efficiencies won't get us out of this situation now. Communities will not be able to save the day and mitigate the full impact of what we are facing. My authority, and I'll just bring it down to ours, is looking at a budget gap of around about £60 million next year. That's on, just to put it in scale, that's on a revenue budget of £845 million, most of which is when I say in terms of that budget's makeup, there's a limited flexibility, let me put it that way, around that. But that £60 million we'll probably mitigate through some of our service concessions to buy us some time for reform. And this is coming back to the core point. But actually, the capacity, even as of a big authority like South Lanarkshire, which is the fifth biggest in Scotland, there is only so many managers, there are only so many staff who can be working on a reform agenda at the one time. And we are now going to face very significant decisions for elected members on what services are provided from the resource that we have.
I suppose I was thinking of something more fundamental. The yep. police told us they went from however many police forces to one. Mm-hmm. So if we were to go from 32 local authorities to 10 or 15... that's not going to come, is it, from local authorities? And no local authority is going to suggest that. That would have to come from central government, wouldn't it?
It would require legislation to do it.
And it would save chief executives and some of the...
Yeah, I would possibly... Let me put it in this way. Show me the business case where moving from 32 to 15 or to 10 or to any number would substantially change the resource position for local government. And then we have a conversation. I'm old enough to have gone through the last reorganisation, and I think it was a very significant eye-opener in terms of the loss of capacity, knowledge, experience, and I'm not sure it merited the disruption in terms of the change. So... if I can maybe just come back to the point about a shared narrative, though. I think this is really important. We need to have a dialogue with communities and with our taxpayers and our residents and our businesses that says this is what is affordable and this is what will be delivered going forward, and it reflects the following priorities. I think the challenge, and if I can just give you an example around last year's budget, the challenge for our communities was COSLA colleagues published a budget reality statement indicating that Scottish local government required £1 billion more because of the...
Yeah, I mean, with all due respect, I'm not really here to just hear about you want more money, because I do understand that, and we'll look at that in the budget.
Yeah.
I'm looking at public sector reform. Should we be... And if we're not going to... I'll just come to Ms Waters in a minute. But if we're not going to change the number of local authorities, are there too many other things? I mean, we used to have health boards and local authorities. That was two. Now we've got HSCPs in the middle, so that's three. Yeah. You know, we used to have two enterprises, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands. Now we've got three. We've got South of Scotland. So, you know, are there just too many bodies out there?
So if I can talk about the local governance review just briefly, the first phases of that, I was the chief executive in Argyll and Bute at the time. So we conducted a roadshow around all the main communities, and we had a set of presentations, boards that people would come in, they did a drop-in in the afternoon and workshops in the evening, and we tried to include the logo of all the public bodies active in Argyll and Bute. And yes, of course, people would know what the NHS looks like, they know what the council looks like, etc. But we had a huge number of people saying, who's that organisation? And you told them. And they say, well, what do they do? And you tell them. And they say, well, how do they connect to me? Well, actually, if you've never heard of them, then they probably haven't. So there are different sectors where you'll find quite a cluttered landscape. You can fill these bits in yourself from other evidence that you've got. I'm not out individual sectors in this session. But you'll have seen a number of reviews recently, and they'll have reported recently, and you can see where I'm going here, that effectively there's name changes but not really rationalisations. So I think it's something like 130 public bodies are in scope of the local governance review, excluding local government and NHS. So undoubtedly the public sector in Scotland is quite cluttered. There has been discussion, for example, around...
Okay, maybe I can move on to Ms Waters now to give her a chance.
Okay.
I mean, you yourself said, Ms Waters, that the funding landscape is cluttered. And, you know, so we've got Scottish Enterprise, we've got Gateway, we've got local authorities, we've now got SNIB as well. Is it all too cluttered?
I don't think it's cluttered if you look at it on a place-based basis and think about the strategic planning that needs to happen in that place. I think that local partners are pretty clear about who they need and what they need locally. And I think this comes back to, we'd like to conclude the local governance review, because that will establish what we need in terms of, and not, I don't mean we as in local government, I mean we as in public services, because it's a local governance review. We must extend it to other partners within who are key players within place-based services. So it's fiscal empowerment, functional empowerment, and as Cleland said, community empowerment. What do communities need? So we need to conclude that. I think, you know, I was at an event, the local government committee ran an event a couple of weeks ago looking at the relationship between Scottish and local government. The headline report is there is a democratic deficit in Scotland. There's a democratic deficit in the UK as well, but, you know, it is marked, the structure of democracy in Scotland compared to other countries. So I would argue that we should be thinking about what do we need in places, and what makes sense in terms of place, what do people associate with, how would they like their services delivered. But it's not just that local government is, I would argue, is the one of the key players, but they reach into so many others, and it's about what needs to be delivered in that local area. Take the logos, who do you need to actually help you deliver those services, and can you move resources from one bit of their service to a bit of a council service, for example, that are doing things that are absolutely complementary. And from a business perspective or a poverty perspective, it would make sense just to pool the money and deliver a consolidated service.
Yeah, well, that's a good point, because the pooling the money idea, I mean, do you think then, rather than actually changing the number of organisations, it's more about the relationship between them? So, for example, we've got the city deals, which seem to have kind of worked to some extent, that like in Glasgow and the west of Scotland, the authorities have kind of worked together, as I understand it. And I think sometimes with the health boards, they do things kind of jointly as well, because they don't have the size themselves. Is that the way to go, is better cooperation?
I think so. And I think And when you see the submission, there's a lot of examples of very good strategic planning within local areas to get the best for that local area. So you've mentioned the city deals. You will not see a community plan or a local outcome improvement plan across the country that does not refer to economic development, child poverty, net zero, etc. But I think the enablers are very, very varied, and the ability to pool resources, etc., is just not there. And unfortunately, it comes back to, you asked about budget pressures versus reform. Everybody retreats into their I must prepare a balanced budget silo, and does what they have to do back at the ranch to make that budget balance, and then comes up for air in kind of April time and says, oh yes, we must look at all that reform stuff, and then it's, oh my gosh, we're reporting budget time back in. We've got to get out of that.
If I can just ask one more question then, to either of you. I mean, especially the islands have suggested this idea of a single authority, that you would put health and local government together in, say, Shetland or Orkney or the Western Isles, or maybe in Fife, where I think they're already quite coterminous. Is that something we should be looking at?
Part of our local governance review. That's what we want to look at.
Right, okay.
Yeah. All I would say is it's what suits that locality. So it shouldn't be mandated from the centre that every area should have exactly the same model. Now, the single island authority has been around for a number of years. It was generated within that locality because the development of health and social care partnerships would actually require initially the Western Isles to create a new entity, and that would be madness. However, the local governance review should look at, in my view, permissive legislation so that whatever structure or whatever partnership suits that particular area would be able to be delivered with a presumption in favour of it. So single island authorities, ostensibly health and the council's functions. However, it could be, you'd mentioned enterprise agencies, etc. It could be that in a certain locality it makes sense to integrate the teams. It could be any other of the 130 other public bodies, but it should be what suits that particular locality.
OK, thanks so much. Thanks, Commissioner.
OK, thank you. Ross, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, Commissioner. Your paper makes calls for empowerment of local government in a number of places, which is no surprise to committee members, a long-running theme for cause. But I wonder if you could distinguish between the powers that you believe are currently exercised nationally that you think, if exercised locally, would result in better outcomes, more efficiencies, versus powers that do not currently exist that you would wish to see created for local governments. So in the first instance, what is it that is exercised nationally that you believe could be more efficiently or with better outcomes exercised by local government if it was devolved?
Thanks, Mr. Gair, and through the convener. We have the opportunity locally to consider how we make better use of the resource that we have. Sarah had mentioned that as a fiscal flexibility, fiscal framework. For us to have the determination as to how best we use those resources, I don't want to make this about teachers and teacher numbers, etc. It's too trite, it's too good an example, actually. But
I do actually have a specific question about teacher numbers in a moment, so if you want to get into it, feel free.
Well, I was going to say it's too obvious an answer, but I'll maybe just expand on it. In our classrooms, there's a number of potential inputs that we could make for our young people that would actually help them towards their achievement. It doesn't always necessarily require a teacher. In fact, bringing in different professions, bringing in people with different qualifications, all the way down to primary schools. You can't tell me that a generically trained primary school teacher is always best placed to provide the 2 hours PE for a child rather than someone with a sports and leisure qualification. That's just another example. But to give you a very quick illustration, our authority decided to, as part of learning catch-up, to put some of its reserve in place, so we funded on a temporary basis a number of teaching posts. We also had some temporary PEF posts. So when the census rolled down last year to December 2022, we had 114 supernumerary teachers on contract on a temporary basis. We then get a letter saying, if you reduce your teacher numbers, we will financially penalise you by the same value. Now, I don't have the budget for those posts, because the posts were temporary. To then have a further restriction placed on the use of budget is a real challenge for us. So what would it look like in future? I think that was the second part of your question. For us, we would like the flexibility to look at how we make use of our resources, how we generate resource. We would like the opportunity to have the ability to plan in a much more longer-term strategic way. And then if I maybe just jump into the world of capital just for a second, the experience that many authorities had around the Levelling Up Fund was a really poor one. It was unnecessarily competitive. So there was an awful lot of resource left in the cutting room floor when awards were made. And it was got tighter and tighter each year. So it became a game of what could you spend by the cut-off date rather than what would you spend on to get the best strategic outcome. So that kind of longer term financial and fiscal empowerment is just an illustration of the type of thing that would help us plan in the longer term. And I'll very, very quickly, because I think this might be of interest to you. So when we look at the Shawfield site, which straddles Glasgow and South Lanarkshire's area, it's the most contaminated site in Europe. It has hexavalent chromium, which pollutes the water table. That means that the water quality down at the Gantocks fails the test. That's how devastating the contamination there is. We've got decades now of investing in there, tens of millions of pounds. We need probably another £50 to £60 million just to deal with it. If we don't, over time, the water table will recontaminate the land that we've remediated. So there's an example of something that's longer term, a big strategic impact, and the economic development potential of that site is enormous, as we've seen from the remediated land now. So that type of fiscal empowerment in future would allow us and our colleagues in Glasgow and potentially Scottish and UK governments to invest over the longer term, reap significant economic benefits, reap significant environmental benefits, and it's an example of that type of planning that at the moment we are absent.
Thanks, sir. There's a huge amount to unpack there, but I want to bring in Sarah in first.
Yeah, I suppose, you know, the obvious one is local taxation and power to raise revenue locally. I mean, we do absolutely welcome the current joint consultation on visitor levy. We've worked really hard and for a long time on that. But actually, we would have preferred a general power to raise revenue and trust local government that it will do the engagement that is required with the business community, with other communities of interest when a local tax is being proposed. It's about that kind of level of trust, instead of having to go back to the beginning and go through the whole legislative process. I mean, it's going to be another 2 or 3 years before, 2 years, I think, until any council can actually use that visitor levy, which will be welcomed by some, it won't be used by others. So I think general revenue-raising powers. There's also this, you know...
Sorry to jump in, but just on the general revenue raising powers point, I think that's a really important one. Is that then one of your preferred outcomes of the New Deal for Local Government, fiscal framework, wider package of work and discussions that are taking place there? Are you currently advocating for that with Scottish Government?
It's been a long-held ask of COSLA about local revenue raising. And yes, we're actually getting, again, through the fiscal framework development, we are getting there, but what we're doing is developing a process for exploration of revenue raising powers, which is welcomed, but it's probably a step that we would say, well, actually, if we had the powers, we wouldn't need that step. Yeah. But what it is it's a good opportunity for local government, experts within Scottish Government and our professional associations to actually say, well, OK, we've got an idea, let's explore it together. And the benefit of doing that is it might be an idea that a couple of local authorities have that others haven't thought about. So if we have that process, then that brings it to the fore. But again, more of a trusted revenue-raising power would be preferable.
Thanks. And Clelyn, you mentioned the Levelling Up Fund, the UK Government, that this committee is very much trying to re-engage with the UK Government on that and trying to get Michael Gove to come back to the committee to give evidence on it. But there's also the point made in the written submission around the value of multi-year funding, which is another area which is ultimately the gift of the UK government. The Scottish government can't give multi-year funding if it's not getting a multi-year settlement. So I'm interested in what direct engagement Solace and COSLA have with the UK government, because every year when we come to the point of setting the grant for local government in Scotland, it feels like it's a very two-way discussion between local government and the Scottish government, when one of your key asks, and actually the overall financial envelope, is ultimately in the power of the third level of government that we're talking about here. So what direct engagement do you have on an annual basis with UK government?
Thanks, Mr. Greer. If I can maybe answer first of all, and I will make a distinction. Quite often we talk on the same topics, but Solace Scotland is a professional network, yeah, of senior executives. So the engagement we have with senior civil servants, UK government, and potentially even in ministers or MPs, is different from the formal engagement that COSLA would have. So we have had the opportunity, a very interesting document, which I believe has just been published authored by Ian Stewart, the MP for Milton Keynes, but who originates from Hamilton, where he has looked at City Growth Deals 2, the successor to the current programme, because the Glasgow one will reach its maturity next year. It takes into consideration the learning from Lough, shared prosperity funds and a whole range of other funding. And there's two very interesting takeaways from the exec summary around that. First of all, it calls for a better engagement between the UK government and the Scottish government to help define shared outcomes. After that point, and this is the interesting point for us, and it talks about long-term European-style length programmes, 7 to 9 years, where there would be a commitment of a single fund rolling all of these individual component parts in and allowing local partnerships through the local authority, coordinated locally through the local authority, but enabling local partnerships and sometimes, as members have mentioned, continuing on a regional basis through the existing growth deals to decide how best to deliver on those outcomes over the longer term. And I come back to just the comment I made earlier. It's better to strategically plan on what will give the best outcomes rather than what you can fund or what you can spend, sorry, by an arbitrary cut-off date. And that would allow for better, longer-term, more impactful investment in our communities. So that's the kind of conversations that we've had at Solace Scotland with senior civil servants in the UK government, but also an opportunity to meet with MPs and ministers who have been on that agenda. But that's in an informal space, the more formal one.
Yeah, I mean, COSLA's president and vice president does meet with Scotland office on a fairly regular basis. Mr Gove's actually coming to COSLA leaders next week to speak to leaders. Predominantly, levelling up funding will dominate that discussion, but actually I think leaders want to move into other spaces as well. I mean, we have, as the committee will know, we have very structured processes around settlement and distribution issues that, through a settlement and distribution group involving our professional associations. If we get to a situation where UK government is making funding available for local government will of course engage on that, but we would want to see more structure. Bid funds, we absolutely would argue that they're not the best use of funding. Next week, settlement and distribution group will consider a bid fund for £500,000 in total.
Use of your time.
That's not from UK. That's a Scottish government funding coming from a portfolio. We do not think that that's good use of anybody's time.
Can I just check though? Does COSLA lobby the UK government to give the Scottish government a multi-year settlement? Because that's the only way that local government is going to get a multi-year settlement.
Yeah, absolutely. It's our ask right through all spheres of government is multi-year. Yeah, and obviously a few years ago we did almost reach a point of having a spending review period of 3 years, but then there was a lot got in the way, which was disappointing.
Thanks. Loads more questions, but I'm conscious of time, convener.
Indeed. Douglas, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you, convener. It's good to see you back. It was good that you brought up local governance review. And as you point out, it's local governance review, not a local government review, because that's something I often bring up in committee and ask government about. But I don't seem to get any answers back on where it is and you know, when we're going to see some output from that. So what's your understanding of it, and when do you think we would be able to see something coming from that local government's review? Because for me, that's public sector reform. That's what we should be focusing on right now.
Borrow a phrase from Sarah, Mr. Lumsden, there was a number of things got in the way, ostensibly COVID and latterly the cost of living issues. So we had the outcome of the first phase of the LGR, which pointed to a second phase of discussion. And if I understand correctly, that's now been dusted down and there is proposed, I think they're calling them community conversations, is that right? Yeah. Over the course of the autumn of this year. So these will be convened discussions. I'm not sure who the Scottish Government have appointed to facilitate. One observation, and it comes from my time as Chief Executive at Gillam Butte, and I'll look to replicate it this time round in South Lanarkshire, was it needs a deeper dive. It needs a longer session with real people, not the representatives of the community organisations only. They obviously have a role, but if you convene a single session as a community conversation, you will have representatives of the normal community organisations turning up and participating. I found the opportunity to literally land in a community, open the doors, give them a coffee, a scone and a conversation, much more enlightening about what people genuinely wanted, because there's an awful lot of assumptions about what people really want, particularly when people talk about community empowerment, as if the communities are just all they're all homogenous and they're all just ready to grab the handles of various services. Actually, what generally people want is good quality public services and an opportunity to influence how they're delivered or where they're delivered, etc. They don't necessarily all want to form themselves into organisations that become employers and actually run some of these services with all the risks that go alongside it. So we need to have that type of valuable conversation with wider communities. So we would look to complement the work that's planned for this autumn. As to when it reports, I'm not sure I've got that. So, yeah.
OK. And maybe for you, Sarah, as well. So will this review give us an idea of how funding should work between different organisations, or is it not going into that sort of level, do we think?
So in terms of the formal local governance review, as Clelyn said, Democracy Matters 2 is being launched again, and that will go through the steps that he's outlined. The Single Island Authority model work seems to be getting a lot of traction within Scottish Government, but what we'd actually encourage government to go back and look at is the submissions from all parts of local government. There was a lot of other ideas out there that were submitted back at the end of 2019. The last meeting with the Cabinet subcommittee was held just before COVID, so we want to revisit all of those ideas. I think as part of the partnership agreement, we're going to need to establish some kind of governance arrangements for that partnership agreement. And at the heart of the partnership agreement is local governance and local empowerment. So I think we need to, the two need to go in. We need to be cognizant of the two, so we don't want to create structures. I mean, we did have joint political oversight for the local governance review, but I think if we've got that and we've got a partnership agreement governance structure, we need to make sure that the two things are speaking to each other. We've got monthly relationship meetings now established with Mr. Fitzpatrick, and local governance review is a standing item on that. So we're really wanting to get the pace back into that, because actually the commitment to do something in this parliamentary term was there from Scottish Government. But I suppose it depends whether we need primary or secondary legislation and what we're actually proposing. Some of it, I think, is we're proposing more flexibility and empowerment at a local level through things like community planning partnerships. And community planning partnerships are a key part of the partnership agreement as well, because we need partners to come to the table. We cannot have councils holding the baby locally. We absolutely need all partners engaged. And I think for too long it's been seen as something that councils do to partners. We need it to be seen as the local mechanism for strategic decision making about matters in local areas.
I completely agree, because you know, we're talking about reform today, and the idea of that is to save cost, and key thing for that is early intervention and prevention. And it seems to me that local government is at the heart of early intervention and prevention. But the problem local government has, you're actually saving money for other people and you don't actually get that back. You know, if I think sports facilities, for example, that will help in the health budget later, libraries, economic development, education will help on, you know, tackling poverty, working with communities will reduce the justice bill. So it's how does that money, if you're looking at true reform, flow back into local government that will help reduce the overall Scottish budget, even though it's not the local government budget it's going to help?
So just to, again, to get, I mentioned earlier in the session that broadly we know what works, but it's extremely challenging when your child protection activity significantly increases, so that your social work staff are spending a greater and greater proportion of their time ensuring that we're appropriately investigating child protection. That's absolutely top priority. But it limits the time that you're able to work within families pre-crisis to do that early intervention work. I think I gave an example earlier around homelessness. Every authority in Scotland has an outstanding a prevention programme in terms of helping people sustain tenancies or to prevent homelessness, etc. But when you're facing the scale of additional presentations and then supporting people in temporary accommodation and trying to find further accommodations for them, again, that limits the capacity of the system. I'll link that to another comment I made, which was just watching that, you know, you don't get pilotitis, that everything comes in short, small bites, etc., and you're able to introduce something. I would point to a good example around the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund is one that has tremendous potential for us to intervene upstream and actually improve parenting skills, provide supports to young people, identify their needs at an earlier stage, that gives us a greater capacity to level the playing field by the time they hit education in a formal sense. Now, it's welcome the line of sight we've got in the budget around that, but having that as a permanently sustained budget that we can rely on year would make it a significant impact. And I'll finish on this final point, which is some of these impacts will be a generation of children. Because if we look at the receptions into care for things like residential care, the high capacity ones tend to be in that 13, 14, 15, 16 year old bracket. But some of the seeds that are growing in terms of some of the challenges those children have are from their very earliest years. So you can be investing for 10 years before you see the true outcome. And I'll do a very last thing, is just to quote Sir Harry Burns when he was Chief Medical Officer. He called for stickability. We do know what works, but you need to invest in it and keep doing it and have that stickability rather than 3 years of this and then try something else and give it a new name, give it a new bit of funding and constantly be moving the services around. Is that helpful?
Mm-hmm. Sarah?
Yeah, and I think there's maybe a misconception within the local governance review that fiscal empowerment is just about getting a set of rules for that governs the relationship between local and Scottish government. It's actually fiscal empowerment across the system so that you have the totality of resource in a place being able to be used in such a way that it goes to the places that it needs to go to do the early intervention. Unfortunately, the acute stuff will always take up a huge amount of the money, but we've just got to gradually start to move it. So when we do a youth work intervention that takes children off the street, puts them into leisure centres, and then the police find themselves with less to do on those Friday and Saturday evenings, at some point we've got to take the leap of faith and say, well, actually, we're better putting the funding into youth work than having those police officers, not as busy as they were when the youth work wasn't happening. Because, we've got to start moving the money about. So fiscal empowerment, it's not just about the rules, it's about being able to move that money and use it where it's needed. And again, that comes back to doing place-based community planning. If community planning didn't exist, and I think it gets a lot of flack and it's had a lot of In a lot of areas, it works really well, but some areas maybe less so. But if it didn't exist, we'd have to invent it, because that's where the place leaders come together. But they need to be more fiscally and functionally empowered to do the work that they need to do.
Or is it even a case of, like, some of the health budget comes to local government because you're spending it on early prevention? Some of the justice budget might come to local government because you're spending it on early prevention.
If we're focusing on outcomes, then absolutely, that's what we need to start doing. But, you know, we're in this one-year budget, retrench into your silos to make your budget balance, as opposed to thinking, how can we focus on outcomes?
Mm-hmm. Last question. Around data sharing, how could data sharing make an impact and remove costs from the overall public purse?
I think there are clear examples in Dundee, the pilot that they've just they're working on. There are absolutely clear there are clear benefits. We can get some more information on that for the committee. I think that Greg Colgan would be more than happy to share some of that information. Just simple things like pushing benefits, you know, and reliefs and things towards families. The councils could do that. They're very well placed, but sometimes there's just barriers in the way. So we need to get over those barriers and empower our local benefits teams to be able to push benefits towards families, as opposed to waiting until there's crisis. But we just keep stumbling against the same data barriers.
So is that data sharing between different organisations, like between Welfare Scotland and local authorities, for example, and health boards, having all that, people having access to
the same data. DWP, absolutely key player in that. But I think it's also about the joined up systems as well that Cleland was talking about. The CHI number is often quoted in terms of being the unique identifier for people in a locality. Is it really? I'm not sure that it is, in the same way that the CMIS identifier works for young people. So, you know, yeah, I think digitisation does come into that. I think there is still work to be done across councils as well, but I think many, many councils are investing in their own customer portals and making sure that they are joined up before they then want to be joined up with others.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, Colin.
No, again, just very briefly, because I wouldn't like the committee to be under the impression that actually data sharing is an immature area. Actually, we've made very, very significant inroads and cross organisations as well. So we talked about DWP, we talk about Social Security Scotland, and the sharing of information between councils in terms of their work with those organisations is quite a mature thing. It's come at very fast pace because of the introduction of Social Security Scotland, etc. We participate in things like the National Fraud Initiatives. I think during the COVID period, the rollout of additional benefits, which was handled by local government from a standing start, was testament to actually how well we shared information between organisations. There are undoubtedly some areas that we could improve, and we touched on some earlier in terms of the system development, but we've got some really, really good examples which you can provide to the committee of how we've used data to digitise processes, to transact, to do things in a much more seamless and human-free way, if that makes sense, you know, without people touching them. There's some extraordinary examples around that. We'll continue to try and get efficiencies around that.
Yeah. OK, thank you. Thanks, Gavina.
Thank you. Liz?
Thank you. I wonder if I can explore what I think is the tension at the heart of this, because you've both been very clear in your evidence this morning, and also for your written evidence, that there is really no disagreement between national government and local government about the principles of what we're trying to achieve, whether that's in terms of addressing child poverty or net zero, whatever these principles are. And that there has to be much greater cooperation between national and local government. But at the same time, you seem to be suggesting that there are difficulties about the delivery, or there's different approaches. And I just wonder if I could take the example of the National Care Service for this, because you were very clear a few months ago, Mrs. Cosla, in response to this committee, when you said that Scottish Government should not consider breaking up the local government workforce, as by doing so we would have a negative and damaging impact on the cohesion and effectiveness of it, but should instead ensure proper funding is provided. So my question is that although we want to establish much better quality social care, particularly in relation to demographic changes, There seems to be a fundamental difference of approach between national government and local government. Would I be right in thinking that on one hand you have national government, which in my opinion quite rightly wants to ensure that there are national standards of good quality care, but a local government that thinks the delivery of that has to be done by local providers because they're the ones that understand it best. Is that the fundamental tension when we come to this policy?
Ms Smith, and through you, convener, this could be my specialist subject, so I'll keep my comments as short as I can. When the work was done originally, and it relied heavily on lived experience and first-hand testimony in terms of the Feely report, and it demonstrated how people felt about the process of accessing care in Scotland, and differences in standards was one very key part. The review didn't go on and ask why or consider why, and that's the real challenge. What underpins all of this, and it's not in the report, is that people's experiences comes from decisions to rationalise care, decide who gets care and who doesn't, who gets a particular level of care when they think that they need more. And those decisions and the rationalisation of care comes from the resource context. So the leaping from that set of conclusions into we need a structural reform that rips the core of about a third of local government out and puts it into a new bureaucratic structure without any evidence as to how that would lead to better care outcomes. We've found a challenge all the way through, and thankfully I think that this committee has been very helpful in reviewing the work done to date and exploring the potential financial consequences of doing that without putting a penny more into care. So this is one example where we share the same aspirations. We've said that all along, right from the beginning of the original Feely review. But we think there are better and more fundamental and quicker ways to actually improve care outcomes than to create a national service. One caveat. There are certain aspects, and it's in the submission that COSLA and SOL has made to the original National Care Service consultation, there are certain things that would benefit from a national approach, and you've alighted in one of them, which is the standards. But there's other areas, like workforce planning, for example, that would benefit from a national approach. But decisions around commissioning of services and the delivery of services belongs at a local level. And I think, actually, now almost every stakeholder who's participated in this work has confirmed the same position. We are still quizzical as to why the vehicle is still hurtling downhill, costing a significant amount of money. Mm-hmm. I think the last count we had was 178 mm-hmm. civil servants working on something that mm-hmm. I think everyone knows is unaffordable. So we would welcome a more open discussion about how we improve care outcomes and do certain things at a national level and leave delivery local.
I come to Mrs. Waters in just a minute. Mr. Snedden, is that a problem about the consultation process? As in, can we achieve both improved national outcomes and certainly quality of standards, but also the right delivery in local circumstances? Can we actually do that, or is there a structural problem there? Or is it just a matter of consultation and ensuring that local and national government are working better together, as you indicated earlier this morning?
This is a personal view, but I think we've now got more of an opportunity to jointly agree the approach around care services. I mean, we can badge something as a national care service, and there are certain bits that would sit neatly within that, which would benefit from being undertaken at a national level. But I think there's more of an opportunity now for colleagues in the Scottish Government and local government to agree what our priorities are and how we would go about that. As I said, it would be helpful if somebody would just stop the vehicle, just put the brakes on right now and refocus on what would improve care outcomes as opposed to a structure-first approach. And you know, even the financial memorandum, as sparse as it was indicating between £250 million and £500 million for the structure alone. Now, that's money we could put to far, far better use at local level. And we need to value care as a service, as a sector, and as a workforce. Very quick example. When a Domino's pizza delivery driver can get £12 an hour plus a pound per delivery, compare that with someone providing the most important and vital personal care, getting paid considerably less than that. That's why we've got recruitment challenges in the sector. That's why we are constantly struggling to ensure that people are getting the care at the right time in the right place. Just a personal
That's very helpful. If the vehicle is still running and you prefer it to stop, irrespective of that, are discussions ongoing between local government and national government about how to improve matters?
Yes, they absolutely are. That's what I'm saying. I think now we've got a better... And this is a broader thing. There's a bit of a reset in relationships. It's something we are working very proactively towards. We welcome it. And there is an ongoing discussion through a number of fora to try to find the right outcome around care services that will fulfil certain aspirations at national level, but actually will leave the delivery, the commissioning, first of all, and then the delivery of care as a local service. And that's what I hear that people want.
Okay. Mrs. Waters.
Yeah, I would echo that. There are some really constructive discussions at the moment about finding finding joint governance arrangements that allow both the Scottish Government's aspirations and local government's hopes for social care to be realised. And obviously it's I don't know whether the timing's good or bad. You know, we're going to be signing a partnership agreement, so signing something that or developing something that has that level of tension could have been problematic, but actually I think we're taking a very pragmatic sort of way through it. What can we call a national care service and what can it usefully do? But I think if you rewind right back, the commitment to the create a national care service was right back in a programme for government without any kind of early engagement with local government. And I think through the partnership agreement, we're hoping that we avoid that. And actually, there's earlier discussion on this is the type of things we're thinking of putting into the programme for government. Do you think this would work? How would this operate locally, etc.? So
just two very short questions to finish. Firstly, do you have a timescale for these new discussions that are happening between local and national government? And secondly, do they include... a lot of discussion about the financial commitments that would be involved from your respective perspectives.
So the timescales, COSLA leaders meet next week and they will consider the early proposals that are being developed jointly. I understand the Cabinet also has to consider that. I understand that the timetables for stage one and two has been pushed into the new year. I think that is helpful. That then allows us to get into the trickier financial discussions that absolutely need to have. At the moment, I think we're focusing on what can it do to support both spheres of government, but there's a lot of detail, and it is helpful that, as I say, the timescales have been pushed into next year.
OK, thank you very much.
Thanks. Ross wants to come in with a wee supplementary.
Thanks. Just very briefly on that point around early engagement on programme for government, does COSLA accept that trust on that would have to be robust and work both ways? And if I'm being brutally honest, that... issues that have happened in the very recent past of leaks from COSLA about Scottish Government policy announcements, we would have to move quite dramatically from that culture. And I say, I presume that's not an officer culture, that's the reality of COSLA being led by 32 councillors from various political persuasions. But early engagement on a PFG, which is confidential until the moment it's published, couldn't work if the level of leaking that we've seen from the COSLA leaders group continues.
So I think that the issue boils down, as you said, to the culture I think that has been created over recent years. So we're not getting sight of things until very, very late. So there is political capital in some of the leaks, I would suggest. But actually, if we had a more constructive relationship earlier in the process, I think you would create a much better culture. And that's certainly what the aspiration for the partnership agreement is, to create that much more positive culture across both spheres.
Thanks.
Okay, Michelle. Oh, sorry. Well, sorry, you ought to come in there.
Sorry, apologies. Just very briefly around the discussions around the programme for government. What would be ideal, and my ambition for the partnership agreement, is that future policy announcements in a particular year consider the implications of putting resource or priority into one particular area. The most frustrating thing for myself and any other local authority colleague is to take the decisions that are necessary to balance our budget and then face criticism or public calls for decisions to be reversed, etc., without a level of ownership. And if I can give you a very quick example, and it's before people pile on me, it's just in 34 years, not once, not ever, has somebody written to me and said the most important thing you could do is provide free bus transport to under 22-year-olds. However, perfectly legitimate national policy, and it went forward. But the consequences of putting resources there still leaves us considering rationalising swimming pools, leisure centres, libraries, money matter service, all the other things that we've had to cut. And yet there's not a shared ownership and a shared narrative. My ambition is that if we are going into straitened times and really difficult times, that central government and local government share a level of narrative and we explain to our constituents exactly what we're facing and why certain decisions are taking place. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Michelle.
Good morning. This has been very interesting. I think you fairly reflected the complexity of the matter at the hand, and I agree with the convener that I think your submission was excellent. Just a quick question, though. I still don't understand why we don't have a shared services centre and why we have a need for 32 different FDs across councils and HR, and I suppose I would throw in legal services there as well. I can understand the complexities in creating shared functions around digital. I can understand it around estates, particularly, you know, Argyll and Bute's a good example, procurement, all of those things. But the financial element in particular is fundamentally accounting for money in, money out. So my question then, therefore, to both of you is, why have you not been looking at creating a shared service centre for this as a simple way of public sector reform? Yeah, Mr. Sten, that's fine.
Yep, convener, I'll come back to that. You will find in the document there's reference to some work that the Local Government Improvement Service, and I think they indicate they mapped 373 separate collaborative or shared service arrangements in Scotland. To be honest, that's the tip of the iceberg. That's just what they mapped in that particular exercise. And if you go across all authorities, you will find a huge number of similar examples. These are really complex businesses without being obvious about it. My own organisation, 16,000 employees, £845 million revenue budget, an HRA beyond that, mm-hmm. and two capital programmes. These are big and complex organisations.
I agree, yep. And I read that bit with interest, and I agree with you that there's clearly been a lot of work done around shared services, but I'm asking specifically about the finance function, why that is replicated across 32 different councils. And in some respects, the work you've done arguably is more complex than creating a shared service centre. So I still think, I don't understand why that's not been considered. And if you think it's not within your gift to consider that, do you think that that is something that should be mandated by government?
Straightforwardly, no. I'll come back to the complexities.
I'd like you, if it's about complexity, what specific complexities are there for a finance director function in a council that merits 32 of them? Yeah. I can see how in a framework principle that every council will have different partners, they may have different methods of payment, but the function itself is duplicated. And I don't understand why we need 32 of them.
Okay. So again, you will find in the submission reference to local authorities have made efficiency around about 25% of costs around the support services, the ones that you're giving an example on. Each authority is a sovereign state and has a different background and makeup. So they have different loan portfolios, they have different investment portfolios, they have different asset bases, different liabilities, different contracts, etc. You would find that, I would imagine, and it's pity one of my colleagues who was due to be here today would give you a director of finance answer on this. I would think it's extraordinarily difficult to imagine a single service that would be in some form centralised that could give the same level of individual care and attention to the finance functions of the local authority. If you're talking about transactional stuff, things like payroll, as an example, again, these are embedded. I think the cost of payroll in local government would compare favourably with any other part of the public sector and a good proportion of the private sector. So pulling it all into one big building somewhere centrally in Scotland, I don't think would be feasible. You would have 32 different sets of terms and conditions for a HR team centrally to try and administer. It would be remote from the locations. I just don't think it would be a practical way forward. And it's not going to generate a massive efficiency given the work that's already been done in efficiency terms.
Okay. Two points on that, just to finish that. I mean, I think in terms of HR, that's actually an argument you've made for a centralised function, that you've got 32 different sets of terms and conditions, particularly where role types are broadly similar in many particular roles. But there are large global companies who have a shared service centre where they have a footprint in a multitude of different countries. And therefore, I struggle to see how on earth you can't have that across 32 different councils. And critically, by having the data set held in one area, actually gives you greater insights into making improvements. So I suppose my final question, I know Ms Waters may want to come in as well. If that's not something you've considered, is it because you haven't really thought about it, or should it be mandated? Your last point before I bring in Mr Waters.
So just to answer your question directly, has authorities thought about shared service arrangements? So, yes, they have. Every one of them has. Mm. Many of them will have gone through the business case development to see whether it's worthwhile and whether you would get the response of local service, to take the HR example, that you would get. And whether that would be worthwhile in financial terms. Also in community terms as well. So again, if I go back to my old patch at Argyll and Bute, in Campbelltown you have the centralised finance and transaction teams and the benefits teams down in that one community. Those jobs were exported into somewhere in the Central Belt. The impact on that particular community, just in terms of community wealth building, would be very significant. Okay. So would I support a central government mandating that all authorities put their HR functions into one? No, I wouldn't. Okay.
Ms Waters, do you want to give it?
Yeah, thank you. And I think that, you know, you would never design... I don't think there's anybody, any entrepreneur out there who would design a business that was like a local authority, because you just would not want to be providing all those services from collecting waste through to caring for older people and everything in between. We are, in many cases, the provider of last resort, so that comes with a number of challenges, I think, from a workforce and a financial perspective. And I think if you were... And in terms of workforce data, we do share workforce data, and I think in terms of workforce planning, we would actually welcome national approaches, and I'm actually meeting this afternoon with the Scottish Government's the public sector pay policy team to look at pay policy across local government, teaching, and other parts of Scottish public service. Fiscal. I think if you were to do what you're suggesting, I think the opportunities then for fiscal empowerment and reaching into the place-based services that you need would be absolutely hampered. I think that there's a bit of a tension at the moment between, you know, replicating what we're all doing, but then having the ability to be responsive locally. And as Clelyn said, that every community is different. They have inherited different assets, liabilities, policies. And I think that if you're truly to empower local governance, then I think having that unique function, I think, is still very, very important.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just one final question from me, and it's regarding the fact that local authorities were not asked by the Scottish Government to submit reform plans to inform the 24-25 Scottish budget. How do you feel about that?
Well...
So I think we were asked to take, in the resource spending review, a complementary approach. I think we feel quite concerned about what is happening in the public service reform space, and we want to ensure that we're absolutely involved with this, because I think there's a danger that this reform happens over here and it doesn't overlap with what's happening on the ground. Some really practical examples, like rollout of electric charging points, you know, you could be doing that across a public service estate locally, but actually there could be plans afoot to change that public sector estate. That would be completely illogical. So I think whilst we'll just get on with reforming locally, and we have done for many, many years, as this mission says, but actually we are concerned about the plans that others are putting in place, because they will touch us on a local level, and we want to make sure that we're involved with those plans.
Yeah. So it'd be more effective and more efficient if it was done collaboratively?
Collaboratively, yes.
Yes. OK, thanks. So I just want to... Sorry, Colin, do you want to comment?
No, sorry.
I didn't think you had. I just want to thank you both for your... excellent evidence this morning. It's very interesting, really a good discussion. Just want to see if you've got any further points you want to make before we wind up the session, if there's anything you feel we haven't covered. Cleland?
Convener, the questions didn't probably allow us to touch greatly on capital or zero emissions / net zero.
To be honest.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I suppose just in reference, one reflection we would have is, you know, again, we probably need a more in-depth dialogue with government around those aspirations. The Accounts Commission colleague came along to the Solace Conference last year and actually said, we can't understand why local government are not shouting from the rooftops in its reporting that they have no prospect of hitting the zero emissions target in 2038, given the current financial context. South Lanarkshire Council has replaced all of its schools. That's 148 schools and 88 early years establishments in the last 15 years, bar two refurbs. So we have, by a country mile, the most modern school estate in Scotland, if not in the UK. And yet my team, looking at what it would require for us to take my non-domestic stock to zero emissions, is in today's money, in fact it's not today's money, it's last year's money, so you can probably inflate this, £550 million. So my capital grant for this year reduced to £21 million, and that's for every commitment. So there is something there around capital we probably didn't get a chance to get into today. Just to say that needs to feature as part of the conversation, because we are, it's one planet and it's our planet, we are as committed to hitting net zero as everybody else, but we need to stop playing at it. Thanks,
Kenny. Sarah, any comment, further comments you want to make? Okay, well, thank you once again for your evidence. We will continue to take evidence on the Scottish Government's public service reform programme at our next meeting, and that concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme. We'll have a 5-minute comfort break to allow official report and our guests to leave. Thank you.